Good morning, Delaware. Welcome to this week's pre-recorded worship service from Ezion Fair Baptist Church.
Your devastation, it can be turned to your deliverance.
Wilmington's most exciting church. And now for this week's pre-recorded worship service.
Hallelujah.
Come on, y'all. Let's put your hands together. Come on. Y'all know what time it is.
Come on, baby.
Come on, put those hands together. Come on.
heavy. Yeah, yeah. Another doomsday news cycle spinning with all the negativity. Yeah. Don't forget you can shut it off. Try to catch a mind when it runs. Easier said than done. Can I get an amen? This is where life is coming at ya. Hands up. Here's your name.
In the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, and I say welcome to the Ezion Fair Baptist Church, Wilmington's most exciting church, the church that love ya and ain't a thing you can do about it. Here at Ezion Fair, we pride ourselves in following after the heart of God. We believe that the Lord Jesus died for all of our sins, and I pray as you worship with us today that you will experience the true power and might of the Almighty God. Again, on behalf of the entire church family, we want to say welcome, welcome, welcome.
Welcome, welcome, welcome to Ezion Fair. We come here today to give them all the praise. We welcome you to Ezion Fair. Ezion Fair. We come here today to give them all the praise. We welcome you to Ezion Fair. We welcome you to Ezion Fair. We welcome you to Ezion Fair.
Here are this week's announcements. Good morning, Ezion Fair family. Join us every Sunday as we worship together at 9 and 11:30 a.m. Join us on Facebook or YouTube every Sunday at 9 or 11:30 by typing in Ezion Fair Baptist Church and subscribe to stay up to date with our broadcasts. Wilmington's most exciting church. Our national prayer and meditation calls occur every Wednesday and Sunday morning at 5 a.m. This is our time as a people of God to hear an encouraging word and pray for miracles in every aspect of our lives. Join our national prayer and meditation call directly by dialing 319-527-2650. Sunday school is held every Sunday at 10:30 a.m. in the Fellowship Hall. Join us as we explore the fundamentals of our faith. Prayer is key for our access to the Lord. Join us every Wednesday for our noonday prayer at 12 noon in the sanctuary. There are four ways to give here at Ezion Fair. 1. Through the PushPay app. 2. Through Zelle with trustees at ezionfairchurch.org. 3. Through check by mail, addressed to 1400 B Street, Wilmington, Delaware, zip code 19801. And 4. On the website at www.myezionfair.org. Click the giving button and follow the provided steps. Thank you for supporting our Ezion Fair family. Need of transportation to the church and do not have a vehicle of your own, give the transportation ministry a call by Friday at 5 p.m. to have a ride arranged for you. Call at 302-652-9114, extension 110.
Some days are weary and you can't see. 6 months. Now we get ready to call it 7 months of a series entitled Better Me. Better Me. All too often we want to become somebody else. We want to imitate their anointing. We want to imitate how they jerk and act holy. This year, I just said, Lord, make me a better me, that I may be able to be used for your glory and for your honor. Anybody with me today? Join us in the book of Esther today. I'm territorying it. I told my wife I'm going to do it, now I'm going to say it. This has been one of the hardest messages for me to. It's so much in this message. And to try to make it a 20-minute message so Deacon Jones won't walk out on me, it's been difficult trying to pull this one together. But the book of Esther, chapter 4, verse 13 through 17. The book of Esther, chapter 4, verse 13 through 17. Listen to what it says. Mordecai sent this message to Esther. Don't think for a moment that because you're in the palace, you will escape when all other Jews are killed. If you keep quiet at a time like this, deliverance and relief for the Jews will arise from some other place. But you and your relatives will die. Who knows if perhaps you were made queen for such a time as this? Then Esther sent this reply to Mordecai. Go and gather together all of the Jews of Susa and fast for me. Do not eat or drink for 3 days, night or day. My maids and I will do the same. And then, though it is against the law, I will go in to see the king. If I must die, I must die. So Mordecai went away and did everything as Esther had ordered him. Look at verse 14 one last time. If you keep quiet at a time like this, deliverance and relief will come for the Jews, will arrive from some other place. Today, just for a few moments, I want to just engage you as we continue in this series, Better Me, to speak up. That's it. Speak up. As a matter of fact, could you just say it out loud? Speak up. You see how timid you are? Come on, say, speak up.
Speak up.
Look at your neighbor, because they hard of hearing. Say, neighbor, you were called to speak up. Now let's give the Lord a hand of praise, everybody. Never should we become comfortable with diminishing our dignity or denying our humanity to satisfy individuals who simply want to ignore and silence us. If we really want to become a better me, it all begins with us discovering our own identity and then speaking up and speaking out loud for ourselves. You know, Brother Sherman, in an era where privilege has become emboldened to belittle people, in a season where disrespect and disregard has become the standing operating procedure for the voiceless, In a time where lies are sold as facts intentionally to make one feel loopy, lost, and stupid, and in a moment when bigotry and hatred has come straight out of the closet, we must make it clear to ourselves and to everyone that we will not be silenced, we will not be muted, and we will not be disregarded any longer. In other words, as we are growing to become a better me, we must commit ourselves to no longer allowing others to talk loud over us, to shout us down, to disrespect us, or to ignore what God has given us to say. Our position really matters. It's not about how much education you have. It's not about how many people you have supporting you. The reality of it is God put his hand on you. And when he put his hand on you, he infused you with purpose. You can't get to where God is trying to take you if you keep letting people push you around. You see, this was a hard message for me because I tend to speak up, but God told me that there would be somebody in church today who've been timid, and he said, no longer can you be timid, because I put you in the place where you are so you can speak up. Can you look at your neighbor and say, speak up, neighbor? God has purpose and plans for our lives. You did not get to where you are because you're so lucky, but you got to where you are because the grace of God is on your life and an assignment has been attached to you. You want to know why? People keep calling you. You want to know why? People keep encouraging you. You want to know why? You keep coming back after being on setback after setback, because there's a calling on your life. And your job is to no longer be silent, but to speak up and say, God, I'm on your terms now. Do I have a witness in here? And that's really the masterful message that we see modeled in this text that we've tagged to teach on today. In a moment of national peril, Esther moved from timidity to tenacity, found her voice, and saved her people. Here's the context, Dr. Hines. Here's the context. Hadassah, you remember her? That was the birth name given to Esther, but was changed to hide her identity upon becoming queen of Persia. This was Esther, who was an orphan at a very early age, given the death of her parents. But her cousin, you know how we do it in the African American community, when one die and they have children, we just take them in. But her cousin Mordecai adopted and raised her as his own. The text doesn't reveal specifically what Mordecai's vocation was, but we can surmise that he was somewhat of a big baller and a shot caller, because we find him daily at the gate of the city. And it's at the gate of the city where all the important decision makers went to make daily decisions. Esther, according to the text, was a very comely looking woman. What's that, Pastor? That's a beauty looking woman. She was fine, fine, fine. fine. As a matter of fact, she was just 1 degree under Sister Curry. But listen to me carefully. This woman was beautiful according to the text. In fact, as a matter of fact, before I go any further, that's just the way the Black African American culture really is. Because when you are a part of the Black culture, you can't help but be fine. Look at your skin texture. Look at how who you are and how you carry yourself. But that's what they said about our sister Esther. In fact, it was her looks that landed her in the likes of the king, and his name was Xerxes. Somebody say Xerxes. King Xerxes was married at the time, but his wife, Queen Vashti, was bold, brave, proper, and principled, because the text reported, stay with me, that after King Xerxes hosted a 6-month party with a 7-day after party, he ordered his wife, Queen Vashti, to dance in public in the nude. You could tell she wasn't a sister at first, but she refused because she knew who she was. When she refused to do what the king told her to do, he immediately kicked her to the curb, and a search for a new queen had emerged. Out of thousands of contenders for the queenship, it was Esther. Somebody say Esther. The Hebrew beauty who caught King Xerxes' eyes, and she became his new queen of the Persian Empire. Things at this point, sorry for trying to rush it up, but it's just so much in it, I'll be here all day. Things had changed dramatically for Esther. She was now living in the palace, but Mordecai remained at the city gates. And while he was down there, he overheard two men. Somebody say two men. He overheard two men plotting to assassinate King Xerxes. And as a result of Mordecai hearing and telling the right people about the plot, King Xerxes' life was spared. The king was so grateful, and he instructed that the incident to be written down in the daily court records. Why? Somebody may be saying to me right now, why is this so important? It's very important because I'm gonna introduce to you now the very next scene of this episode. We meet a man by the name of Haman. Somebody say Haman. Haman was an ambitious narcissist, something like Donald Trump. He had the same type of attitude. The text didn't disclose how Haman became second in control of Persia, but what we do know is once he got there, he used his power for his own personal and political benefit. It was Haman who demanded that every person who saw him was to bow down and honor his presence in a customary fashion. All of the cronies and flunkies, they all bowed down whenever they saw Haman, except for one man, and that man's name was Mordecai. Somebody say Mordecai. Mordecai was not mortified or intimidated by Haman. There was only one God whom Mordecai bowed to, and it wasn't him called Haman, but it was Jehovah. Do I have a witness in here? When Haman then witnessed the defiance of Mordecai, he was so irritated and infuriated that he not only wanted to destroy Mordecai, but he wanted the death of everybody that was connected to him. Before I go any further, that's what hatred will do for you. You won't just go after an individual, but you'll go after the whole family. Do I have a witness here? So while King Xerxes was recovering from his 190-day hangover, Haman convinced him that it was necessary to exterminate all of the Hebrew people. Stay with me, because I'm coming to a close here. Not understanding the hand of God. Let's back up for a second. First, we got to remember all the things that already happened. She was beautiful. She was an orphan. But then she ends up in the king's palace as his wife. But her uncle, or her cousin, shall I say, continued to stay at the city gate. He already averted one suicide attempt, but guess what? There was another one that was now here. Mordecai overheard that something that the king had just approved at the hand of Haman. Somebody say Haman again. Something happened with Haman. He was just messed up, and he decided to tell the king, now that he's still a little drunk, we gotta kill all of the Hebrew people. And the king agreed. Haman, sitting at the city gate, Mordecai, he heard what Haman had done and how the king had consented for it to happen. Now we at a place where he remembered something that God had done. What did God do in front of it? He called his cousin to be able to be in the king's palace. I don't care where you are, my brothers and sisters. It's all by the strategic hand of God. God knows what he's doing. Your job is to follow what God is doing. Do I have a witness in here? God had positioned Esther at this point to be in a place where she did not have to worry so much in the front end, because life had changed for her. She was the new beauty queen, but something happened. She gets a word from her cousin that they're about to kill us. They're about to create a problem for us, and I need for you to go in, and I want you to see the king and tell the king what is going on. Wait a minute, brother cousin. You don't understand. Things have changed for me. It's not the same way it used to be. Hold up, cuz. I know you still down in the hood at the city gates, but I'm up in the palace now, and we got protocol. And protocol says you can't be up on the king unless he bids you to come. But wait a minute, I hear Mordecai saying to her, I hear you, cuz, and I know you think you got it made, but God has called you for such a time as this to speak up. You cannot sit in your comfortable palace and not speak up. My brothers and my sisters, I don't care where life carries you. When God has given you an assignment, you gotta speak up. I know it's comfortable to be making the money that you make. I know it's comfortable to be living in the community that you live in. I know it's comfortable to be able to do the things that you do. But when God says speak up, it's time to speak up. Do I have anybody in here who understand that when God says speak, you gonna have to speak? But then something happened. She says, Morty, I hear you, cuz. I hear you. Okay, I hear you. I hear you. Mm-hmm. You want me to go to the king. Mm-hmm. And you want me to speak up. You want me to talk. Cuz, did you know that if I just pull up on the king, I can be killed? Cuz, you want me to do something to take my life. Brothers and sisters, if God got you to where you are, God will take you through the next phase. Stop believing that God only got partial power. God's got all power. You know you don't deserve to wear the clothes you're wearing today, but you got them on because of the grace and the mercy of God. I didn't got no help in here today. Let me ask my question so I can get out of your way. Here's the question. In order for us to become a better me, why do we have a demand on our lives to speak up? Simple. 2 points. Two. Uno, dos. Okay? Two. Here's number one. To gain access to our purpose. to gain access to our purpose. Somebody say, to gain access to our purpose. The text said, if you keep quiet at a time like this, deliverance and relief for the Jews will arise from some other place. You don't want God replacing you, but you and your relatives will die. Who knows if perhaps you were made queen for such a time as this? Mordecai's point was crystal clear. Esther's life could have potentially been lost by going directly and speaking to the king, but it would have certainly been lost if she didn't go and speak up. Why? Because that was her divine purpose. Has it ever occurred to you that the reason why God blessed you the way he blessed you was so that you can turn around and bless somebody else? Could it be possible that the reason why God kept you like he kept you was so that you can protect somebody else? Is it possible that the reason why God lifted you, promoted you, elevated you, made a way for you, opened doors for you, and fought battles for you was so you can do it for somebody else? Whenever there's a divine assignment on our lives, you can't allow positions or pressures to divert the agenda of God's divine purpose on your life, which means stop allowing stuff to shut your mouth. It mesmerizes me when I'm fighting for those in the community, how many times people will thank me for sticking with them. Because all too often we get an issue, then we run away from it. But listen to me, until the issue is resolved, learn how to stand up and speak up. Do I have a witness in here? Because there's a call on your life and there's a victory that has to be won. Please note this, that faith, truth, love, and justice are always under attack. There's no pursuit of self-awareness that has not been opposed. No resurrection that has ever not been resisted. There's been no love that have never been challenged. You have to speak up and stop being timid. Esther was confronted with the greatest decision of her life. She knew the ramifications of speaking up. But in verse 16, she says, go and gather all the Jews who are in Susa and fast for me. And then I will go to the king, which is not according with the law. But if I perish, let me perish. In this single moment, Esther went from being timid to being tenacious. Theologian Tim Keller wrote it this way. Esther's language was that of identification, motivation, and obligation. She identified with who she was and to whom she belonged. She was motivated because she had faith in the real God, and she was obligated to help somebody else. It was at this point when Esther realized her purpose. Esther was put in the palace to protect her people. My brother and my sister, please note, you were put where you are to help somebody else. You are here for a reason. You survived for a reason. You made it for a reason. You are here to do something. Don't allow a comfortable life to divert your purpose. In times like these, we need to put our trust in the Lord, because God will never fail us. In times like these, we need to make sure that we have an anchor, because God is always moving. And when God is moving, moving. He wants you to move with him. Stop being afraid of your bosses. Stop being afraid of the people above you. Stop being afraid of the politicians. Stop being afraid of people who look bad. You better learn how to lift yourself up and say, God, if you brought me to it, God, you gonna bring me through it. Do I have a witness? But finally, and I'm done, finally, not only is there a demand on our lives to speak up to gain access to our purpose, but also to shift the climate of our lives. To shift the climate of our lives. Watch this. After prayer, Esther became tenacious. After prayer, Esther became relentless. After prayer, she was much stronger, bolder, and wiser than she ever was. Because prayer changes things. If you want a shift in your life, I dare you to pray. Because when nothing else works, prayer does. If you are afraid, learn how to pray. Because when you pray, it opens up heaven and God gets his attention. Listen to this. I know y'all got excited because I was getting ready to get excited, but I got a little bit more word I want to give you. The king extended his golden scepter in her direction. I'm just going to give you the end of the story. The king, after they prayed, I don't want you to forget that. The king extended his scepter in her direction and gave her a blank check to move about as she desired. Hold it. Don't get excited. Because when God blesses you, you don't have the freedom to do what you want to do. You have to do what he's called you to do. Look at what she did. Look at what she did. She requested the king's presence at a banquet. Wait a minute. She said, I'm going to tell the king. My people are about to die. But when she get in front of the king, she didn't tell him that. She said, oh, king, would you go to a dinner with me? The king consented. Esther said, I got one more favor. Could you please order that Haman attend to? You better look at the hand of God, y'all. You better look at the hand of God, y'all. You better look. I know y'all got talking about. You better learn this story. Some of us talk too much. Some of us talk too fast. Some of us move too fast. Not Esther. Esther said, King, I can see her prancing around. I haven't seen you in 30 days, King. But can you stop by for just a moment? But when you come, can you order that Haman also attend? And when Haman got the word that the king wanted him to go to a banquet, he was overjoyed. When the enemy is sleeping, God is well awake. But Haman still had a murderous hatred spirit against Mordecai in his spirit. So Haman moved forward with ordering the gallows to be built with every intention of hanging Mordecai before the week end. Time is running out. What's gonna happen? You asking for a dinner and I'm about to die. What's going on? Well, I just need to stop there for just a moment. And I want to give you four little points Because before I go to the end of this sermon, I want you to walk out of here with these facts in your mind. When all seems lost, it isn't. Number two, when no one seems to notice, they do. When God appears absent, he's not. And number four, when what goes around, it comes around. Because God's delay is not God's denial. I'm going to preach my little sermon and I'm going to go on to my seat. Esther held her banquet. It was at the banquet. Somebody say the banquet. It was at the banquet when Esther told King of Haman's plot to exterminate her people. She could have done it before now, but she gave Haman a chance to repent and relent. But Haman was still fixed on killing the Jewish people. It, my God, I'm so glad that when the king heard it, what Haman was gonna do, it infuriated him. And the king ordered that Haman be executed on the same gallows that he built for Mordecai. What the old folks used to say, if you dig one ditch, you better dig two, because the first one may be for you. Richard Seed, he said something. He said, nothing is too high that it's above God's providence. Nothing is so bad that God cannot draw good out of it. And nothing is so wisely plotted that God cannot disappointed. Good afternoon. Good morning. Good evening. I gotta leave you, but I want you to make up your mind wherever life lands you that you gonna speak up. Because when you speak up, your fears are diminished. Let God arise and your enemies be scattered. Speak up and watch things happen. Speak up and watch God work. Speak up and watch burdens relent. Speak up and watch mountains move out of your way. Speak up and watch valleys rise up. Speak up and see problems solved, bills paid, and dreams realized. Speak up and don't you let nobody shut you up. When God has his hand on you, God, he'll protect, guide, and keep you. When God has you in his arms, no weapon formed against you will be able to prosper. God, I thank you. God, I praise you. Why am I doing it? Because he keep on making ways. He keep on opening doors. He keep on bridging
an assignment. She didn't know. That's why we got to stop discounting people. She was an orphan. She was an orphan. Her parents had died. Cuz took her in. She got the attention of the king because God knew what was going to happen over here when they were still back here. The trajectory of your life has already been mapped out. God is strategic. Nothing can get to your life that God does not sanction. It may hurt. I told him at the 5 this morning. It may hurt because we struggle with being spiritual beings in a natural world. But the closer you are to your flesh, the more devastating things are. But the closer you get to God, you'll begin to quote scriptures. No weapon formed against me shall prosper. All things are working together for the good of them who love the Lord. When my mother and my father forsake me, then the Lord shall bring me up. When I don't have nothing, I have God. I don't have nobody who understand one thing. God is our refuge. What does that mean? That means we're safe under his covering. You might not be safe under mine, but we're safe under his covering. When he is covering you, nothing can harm you. When he's covering you, nothing can take you out. When he's covering you, do I have any covered folks in here today? You online, you watching us by TV, whichever way you're watching, listening to us by radio. I want you to know it's time to speak up. It's time to speak up. Why? Because God delivered you so you can help somebody else. Speak up. Be heard. Don't be discounted no more. Don't let the chicken dinners mess you up. Stand firm in the liberty wherewith Christ hath made you free. And be not again entangled in the yoke of bondage. God has set you free. Now speak up. And don't let those $3 people who talk about, oh, you just arrogant. I is. Because when it comes down to the Lord and what the Lord is calling, I ain't got time for protocol. It's time to speak up. Stand on your feet, everybody.
That concludes this week's pre-recorded broadcast. Join us every morning for our 9 a.m. and 11:30 a.m. services. Or watch our 9 a.m. live stream on YouTube or Facebook at Ezion Fair Baptist Church. And don't forget to tune in to our other shows, Coffee with Curry at 11 a.m. and The Source at 5 p.m. Stay blessed, and we'll see you next Sunday.
There's something for everybody to do here at EFBC, starting with our youth ministries, the Warriors cheerleaders, Angel Tree Ministry, the Girls Serving with a Purpose, the Rockin' with Jesus Youth Choir, the Scholarship Ministry, the Piercing the Darkness Ministry, the Holy Soldiers Brotherhood, and of course, the Daughters of Zion. Adult ministries include the Men's Fellowship Ministry, EFBC's Singles Ministry, the Wells of Wisdom Ministry, the Golden Angels Praise Dance Ministry. The Noonday Prayer Ministry. And the Marriage Ministry. Lastly, in-house ministries include the Greeters Ministry, the Miracles of Mercy, Sunday School Ministry, the Outreach Ministry, the Ushers Ministry, and the Transportation Ministry. All this in store at Ezion Fair Baptist Church.
This is Pastor Kirk, pastor of the Ezion Fair Baptist Church, Wilmington's most exciting church, the church that love ya and anything you can do about it. What we're going to do today is we're going to have a real good conversation. I'm excited. Come on! Every Sunday at 11 a.m. Why don't you call somebody real quickly? Tell them Coffee with Curry is on. And let's get after it.
Local news and politics in the city of Wilmington, Delaware. The latest headlines with your host, Dr. C.T. Curry.
But they get rich, getting new cars, getting new houses, getting new opportunities, but the community is still getting nothing.
And co-host Kobe Owens.
And from that time, we have slowly seen our democracy become under attack.
Weekly episodes. Sundays at 5 p.m. The Source.